Okay, fine. So this is work that I have not spoken about, I think, at IIT Bombay before. I was at the Indian Institute of Science for the last 6 months before I moved here. This is work that started then. My co-authors are Neil Dara Mishra, who is an Inspire faculty fellow in the CSA department at IISc. Aditya Gopalan is an assistant professor in ECE over there. Okay, and this is recent work. It hasn't been published yet. And as you will notice, there's a lot of rough edges and a lot of room for ideas to be refined. And I do hope like this will be a session where the audience can actually think about some of these problems and also help me out maybe with sorting out some of my thinking. Okay? So the problem is that of MDP planning. So I will begin by describing that problem in some detail. Good. So we'll spend some time formulating, like describing that problem precisely. And maybe about half the talk, I don't mind spending about half the talk talking about existing ways of dealing with this problem, because that really set it up for us. Right? There are at least three clearly demarcated approaches for finding an optimal policy in an MDP, including linear programming, value iteration, and policy iteration. And having done that, it will easily fit in how our contribution adds to this landscape. In particular, we introduce an algorithm called planning by guessing and policy improvement. I'll present the algorithm along with its analysis. I do hope to have like 5-10 minutes at the end of this for, I think, relations between this approach and linear programming, which is a topic I don't know very well, especially there are people in the audience who know linear programming and simplex and pivoting and all that very well. I think you'll be able to appreciate much of the connections that I'm going to outline, and I hope also contribute. You can ask me questions at any time, all right, just make yourself visible. Okay. MDP planning. What is an MDP? An MDP is a Markov decision problem. It's a standard abstraction for sequential decision making. If there's an agent in an environment, it must take actions that maximize its long-term gain. How must it act? This question is mathematically formulated using a Markov decision problem. A Markov decision problem comprises a set of states, S, a set of actions that is available from each state, a reward function that gives a real value return for every action taken from every state. You take an action from a state, you'll get a number as a reward, right? And that is specified using the reward function. The transition probability matrix essentially governs how transitions to next state happen. Every time you take an action from a state, the transition matrix specifies a probability distribution over next states, right? And so you will be stochastically transported to one of these states based on the probabilities in this matrix. Right, so S, A, R, and T. What an agent is interested in doing is to behave optimally. And an agent's behavior is encoded through what's called a policy. A policy is a mapping from states to actions. By this definition, it is a policy that is Markovian, that is deterministic, that is stationary. These are various things. But in essence, think of a policy as a mapping from states to actions, which means from every state, the policy tells the agent which action it must take. Okay? And you can imagine that associated with every policy, there is the long-term return that the agent will gain by following the policy, right? And there is also associated with, you can also associate the long-term return with every state, right? So precisely, V pi of S, the value of policy pi starting from state S, is in expectation, the reward at the next time step, plus the reward at the next time step, plus the reward next time step, all the way to infinity, except that we discount future rewards by a discount factor gamma, which is a number between 0 and 1, in order to keep this number bounded. Okay, this is a definition of expected long-term reward under what's called the infinite cost model. You sum your rewards to infinity, you discount them using the discount factor. There are alternative definitions. There's something called average reward. There's something called total reward. If you assume that your MDP will always take you to states, right? Which are like sink states, where your policy ends, then you don't need to discount. Even without discounting, you can guarantee that this number will remain bounded. Okay? So we've said that an MDP has states, actions, rewards, transitions. We've said what a policy is. A policy is not a property of the MDP, right? A policy is a separate object. You can think of the discount factor as a part of the MDP. So an MDP, in essence, is specified by a set of states, a set of actions, a reward function, a transition function, and a specification of how much the future matters, right? If gamma is small, right, then the expected long-term return is not going to depend that much on the real long-term. The larger you make gamma, the closer you make it to 1, the more your long-term rewards matter. The planning problem precisely is, given an MDP, given S, A, R, T, and gamma, find a policy pi star from the set of all policies pi, such that this is true, such that from every state in the MDP, following pi star will give an expected long-term return that is at least as good as that you will get by following any other policy pi in the MDP. So let me say this in English, okay? You are in an MDP, following any policy, you're going to get expected long-term returns from every state, right? The expectation is because there's stochasticity in your transitions. A policy pi star, by the way we have defined it, is one from which following pi star is necessarily at least as good as following any other policy in terms of this expected long-term reward metric from every state, okay? Planning problems, given an MDP, can we find such a policy pi star? Now, the problem is well defined. Given an MDP, indeed there exists a policy pi star. So, this problem is well defined. The question is, how difficult or easy is this problem of finding such a policy pi star? Questions? Yes?
So, since that policy is really a pasting of all policies beginning at each state, right?
What's a pasting?
So for pi is from S to A, right?
Right.
So, I mean, is this, that for all S, is
the
starting point important or not really?
I
don't understand this notation.
So it might be that you never reach certain states, right?
No, V pi S,
right,
is, so if the reward, if mm-hmm. I start, use policy pi and start at S.
Correct.
Now, I mean, in that sense, if some other policy is better starting from S prime, then I can join the two policies that for S I started pi and for S prime I started pi, we use pi prime. That is also another policy.
Yes, that policy presumably dominates both the other policies
correct.
That you
so
mentioned.
So in that sense, this is really a local state question. You know, starting at S, what is the best policy? Can it be reduced to that?
They are not fundamentally very different, right? Because if you have lots of local policies, I'm just agglomerating all of them, pasting them and calling them one policy because I've defined it this way. Good. Yep? Okay, fine. For the purposes of this talk, please bear in mind that we are in an MDP which has a finite set of states and actions. In particular, let n be the number of states and k be the number of actions. Alright, we're going to derive bounds in terms of n and k. Alright, so let's keep that with us as we go along. Okay, how might we find an optimum policy in an MDP? We look at three different ways in which we can do it, and really this third family policy iteration is the one that is closest to our own contribution in this work, right? I'll spend more time on policy iteration than the other two preceding methods for good reason, right? For the reason that it will motivate what we end up doing and give us a baseline with which to compare it. And then I'll go into some detail describing what our algorithm is. Fine. Now, it can be shown, right, that the value function corresponding to the optimal policy pi star. Now, the value function is just a way of representing the values that you will get at every state. The value function is a vector with n entries, with one entry for each state, corresponding to the value of that state under that policy. In particular, if you take the optimal policy, its value function, which is V of pi star, is usually denoted V star. It can be shown that V star is the unique solution of what's called Bellman's optimality equations, okay? So this ought to look like something like the expected long-term return to you, all right? So R of SA is the reward that you get by taking action A from state S. And with this probability, you will go to state S prime, right? T of SA, S prime is the probability with which you'll go to S prime. And then the subsequent long-term reward that you will get is encapsulated in V of S prime, all right? By putting a max operator here, what we are saying is, under an optimal policy, you will always be taking those actions that maximize this sum, immediate reward plus gamma times the next reward from the next state, all right? So, this is like basic textbook kind of material, that the optimal policy is the unique solution of Bellman's optimality equations. Now, it turns out, right, that Bellman's optimality equations are not particularly straightforward to solve. These are not linear equations, right? You have How many equations do we have like this?
Models.
Sorry? Correct. We have one for every state, right? And there are n states, so there are n equations like this. If you take the state values to be unknowns, then you have n equations and n unknowns, but they are not linear equations. Turns out, though, that you can derive a linear program based on Bellman's optimality equations, right? So you will see that maximizing this quantity, or the sum of these n numbers, subject to these constraints, of which there are n times k, one for every state action pair. Solving this linear program will amount to finding V star. The solution of this linear program, this unique, will indeed be a solution of Bellman's optimality equations. So what have we done? We've done whatever textbook material to say that if you want an optimal policy, at least you can get its value function by solving Bellman's optimality equations. You can solve Bellman's optimality equations by solving this linear program. This is a linear program with n variables and n times k constraints. There's an alternative way of formulating this. You can make a linear program with nk variables and n constraints. But at any rate, what's the complexity of solving a linear program? I know, yeah, but I hope somebody would spell it out anyway. Right? So one way you could do it is using an interior point method, right? You can get it done in pseudo polynomial time. That means polynomial time and the number of constraints and variables, which is n and k. And there is yet a dependence on the precision to which you want your answer. Or equivalently, if you're representing your MDP with a certain number of bits, right, that dependence will come into your bound. We do not know a strongly polynomial algorithm for linear programming. Fine, yeah, so this is that, okay? Fine, so linear programming is one way of doing it. Value iteration is a very contrasting style of finding the optimal policy. So this gives you formally the value function of the optimal policy. It's very easy to derive the optimal policy from the optimal value function, all right? So just take that from me. More standard approaches for MDP planning use dynamic programming, right? Which means they try and solve sub-problems and then use those solutions to solve bigger problems, and value iteration is one such approach. How value iteration progresses is as follows. You start with an arbitrary initialization of your optimal value function. So V0 is an arbitrary n-length vector, all right? Repeatedly apply the following iteration. Vp plus 1 is going to be an update that depends on the reward function and the transition function applied to Vt. Okay, essentially what we're saying is we have a current estimate of our value function. We're going to improve it by applying the following operator. This is called the Bellman optimality operator. And it is possible to show that you keep doing this, you will converge, and you will converge to V star. Okay, the number of steps that this will take is what is going to interest us. So each of these updates themselves is fairly simple, right? It's like an order n times k, something like that. Update. You have n entries you have to update inside for each of these. Maybe n squared k, right? You have n elements in your V. Each of them depends on the n elements in your previous V, and you have to take a max over all the actions. So that's n squared k. It's polynomial, right? Strongly polynomial in n and k. So what really governs the complexity of this algorithm is the number of iterations it's going to take to converge. And indeed, it will take as many as polynomial in nk, the size of your representation, and 1 over 1 minus gamma to converge. In essence, gamma, 1 minus gamma, 1 over 1 minus gamma is the length of our horizon, right? If gamma is our discount factor, what we are saying is up to 1 over 1 minus gamma, the values of states that we might reach are going to influence our current value function, right? Beyond that point, up to machine precision, after that point it does not matter, but up to that point it does. Right? So you really cannot bypass this dependence on 1 over 1 minus gamma, which comes into our bound. So linear programming gave us poly nkb. We have an additional 1 over 1 minus gamma here, which is not always bad in practice, because people find the linear programming using simplex or using your best solver, cplex, does not do nearly as well as these approaches such as value iteration. Value iteration is going to do much better if, for example, you can initialize with a good value function, right? Or you have some way of eliminating actions. There's lots of tricks that you can do, but in a formal theoretical sense, you can construct MDPs in which this dependence on 1 minus gamma shows up, right? And it can become arbitrarily bad as gamma becomes closer and closer to 1. Yes? Okay, so we've looked at linear programming, we've looked at value iteration. Next, we will look at policy iteration, but before that, it's very useful for us to know a subroutine that policy iteration will use. And this is a very common subroutine that one needs to know if one's doing MDPs and reinforcement learning and planning. All right? So, the nonlinear equation that I spoke to you in the context of linear programming were Bellman's optimality equations. Here, we will define something called Bellman's equations. Okay? Bellman's equations are written down when you are given a policy, right? Bellman's optimality equation, we're taking a max over all the actions, but let's say you're given a policy pi. Remember that we defined V pi of s as this, right? This expected long-term discounted reward. You can write the same thing recursively. Instead of writing V pi of s as this expectation, you can instead write it in terms of V pi of s itself, right? Essentially, gamma times R2 onwards might be replaced by gamma times V pi of the state in which we are. That's what's happening when you fold it in recursively. And this set of equations, which depend on pi, right? This is V pi of S. This is not V star of S. And again, on the RHS, we have V pi of S. It's called Bellman's equations. All right? V pi is called the value function of pi. And just like V pi, we also define something called Q pi. This is the action value function of pi. So V pi is the expected long-term return. V pi of s is the expected long-term return of pi starting from state s and following pi, right? The slight difference that we need to define Q pi is, Q pi of s a is the expected long-term reward that the agent gets by taking action a from state s, right? It just does it one time, and then subsequently it follows pi. Right? There's just this one step difference between Q pi and V pi. That is the action value function, and therefore by that definition, V pi of s is exactly Q pi of s, pi of s. If your a is the action that your policy is specifying, the two are exactly the same. It's useful for us to know this also. All right, these are both definitions. Now, I asked you this question about Bellman's optimality equation, but given a policy pi, how many equations will we have like this? N again, right? One for each state on the LHS. How many unknowns do we have? N. These are linear equations, and you can solve them using Gaussian elimination, using your favorite solver in time that is, let's say, order n cubed, right? Or n to the 2.23, whatever. Yes? So given a policy, what we have just seen is that you can find the value of that policy by doing what is called policy evaluation by solving the set of linear equations, all right? This set of equations is called Bellman's equation, and this whole operation is called policy evaluation. You're given a policy, you want to find what its value function is, or somewhat equivalently what its action value function is. You can do this in n cubed time, for all practical purposes. Yes? But how is this different from Bellman's optimality equation is what we were trying to do there? Correct. Bellman's optimality equations may have no policy that they're working with, right? They're working with the optimal policy in an abstract way. And finding that naturally is hard, right? Which is why you have to do the linear programming, it takes a long time. But given a policy in n cubed time, you can, or n cubed plus n squared k or something like that, time, you can find out what the value function of this policy is. Okay, and this is a subroutine that will be used in the next family of planning methods that we will see, which is called policy iteration. So the first family was linear programming, the second was value iteration, the third is policy iteration, and I have to set up a little bit in order to explain what policy iteration does. Okay, so for a given policy pi, let I of pi define the set of all states for which there exists an action whose Q value from that state strictly exceeds the value of that state under that policy itself. So this Q pi of s is basically V pi of s, right? So s is inside here if s is such that the action that currently you're taking under pi can be improved by taking another action in the sense of Q. So it's complicated to say this math. It's also complicated to say in English because there are so many variables. Okay, so if instead of pi of s, I took a from here for one step and then did pi subsequently, then what I'm saying is s is such a state that the former would have a higher expected long-term return than the latter, right? And all such states are included in this set I of pi. All right? So as we just saw, Q of pi is easy to derive given a policy pi. You do policy evaluation, you get V, you can also get Q. And if you know Q and V, right, you can just run over all your states, do this comparison and see if every state, whether it belongs to I pi or it does not. Right? So given a policy in something like N cubed time, you can compute Q pi and I pi. The key statement governing this entire family of thinking, right, this policy iteration and the whole approach here is the following, right? If I of pi is empty, then pi is necessarily an optimal policy. And the opposite too, right? If pi is not an optimal policy, then I of pi will not be empty. So what does that mean? You have some policy, you evaluate it, and you see if there are states that can be improved. If there are states that can be improved, then the policy is necessarily not optimal. On the other hand, if you find that your policy, you evaluate it and there are no states on which you can improve it, then the policy is necessarily optimal. This will become the basis for designing algorithms in the family of policy iteration. Okay, and this is how we will do it. Let us assume that we are not with an optimal policy. Let pi be a policy such that I pi is not empty. Let us arbitrarily choose a subset, a non-empty subset of I of pi, and call that C of pi. So I of pi really is a property of your policy. Okay, it's defined. C of pi, on the other hand, is a quantity that we choose. You can think of it as a random variable if you want. Okay, but we can choose it in any which way we want. It is a non-empty subset of I of pi. So if I of pi has three states, maybe we pick one of them, and we're going to call that C of pi. All right. Define now a policy pi prime as follows. Pi prime is going to be exactly pi of s if s does not belong to C of pi. If, on the other hand, s belongs to C of pi, then pi prime is going to take an action that maximizes q pi of s a from s. Okay, now I'm going to say this in English. You have a policy pi, you evaluated it, you found that I pi has five states, all right? Arbitrarily, you're going to pick a non-empty subset of these five states. Let us say maybe we pick three states. Now we're going to define pi prime as follows. In all the states except those three, we're going to stick with pi. But in these three states, we're going to take those actions that maximize q pi of s a. All right? Fine. So pi prime is a policy that is derived from pi by evaluating it and then choosing the subset. Okay? The policy improvement theorem is essentially this, that derive pi prime for any arbitrary choice of choosing this C pi, okay? For every such choice, it can be shown that for every state, value of that state under pi prime will be at least as good as the value of the same state under pi. There will exist at least one state in which pi prime is strictly better in terms of these values. It means that by improving from pi to pi prime, this is called policy improvement, by the way. This operation, right, of going from pi to pi prime by evaluating and improving is called policy improvement. If you do improvement, then pi prime will state-wise dominate pi. That means in every state, it will have a value that's at least as good. There will be at least one state in which it's strictly better. Okay? So maybe let me ask the audience a question at this point, right? So let us say we start with some policy pi, and now I've given you this technique that if you do policy improvement, you can go to this policy pi prime that has this property that it will state-wise dominate pi. Does this tell you a way of planning, of trying to find the optimal policy? Sorry?
Yes.
What technique is that? How would you apply this to find the optimal policy?
Use pi prime at s instead of pi and splice the splice in pi prime.
That's pi prime, right? Huh. But I want to find the optimal policy.
Keep doing it.
I don't know what keep doing it, right? It should strike you that by doing this repeatedly, we will reach the optimal policy. Now, why is that? let us start with any policy pi, do improvement. We go to pi prime, we'll evaluate pi prime. If pi prime can be improved, we'll improve it to pi double prime and keep doing this. Why will this reach the optimal policy? Because, sorry? In terms of this definition, right? But yeah, you can just say it more basically in terms of this, right? If pi prime or whichever policy you are is not an optimal policy, then it will have this IF pi, right? And when you do the IF pi, this will happen. And because the number of policies, and you'll never revisit the same policy by using this iteration, right? You go from pi to pi prime by improving, and then you keep doing this. You'll never revisit the same policy because, as Nutan mentioned, this is happening. You can not do this endlessly because the number of policies is itself finite. In an MDP with n states and k actions per state, what's the total number of policies?
K to the n,
right? You can take any of k actions in any of your states, so k, n times. So that's k to the n, and so it has to terminate, and it will not terminate in a locally optimal policy because of this, right? Because if it is not optimal, then IPI will not be empty. This is a sound algorithm. And what do you think will be the number of iterations? What's the trivial bound on the number of iterations that this algorithm should take?
Number of policies
itself, right? This is k to the n. Good, okay? So this is exactly what we'll see on the next slide. This is an algorithm that was, I think, introduced in the 1960 textbook by Howard. You start with an arbitrary initial policy. You keep repeating this loop. You evaluate pi. And find out its improvable set. You pick a subset from this improvable set and improve, right? Do policy improvement. You keep doing this until you hit an optimal policy. Okay? Now,
question?
Yes.
So why can't C of pi be equal to I of pi? Why?
That's exactly what it is in Howard's paper, right? That's for the reason that I have to explain things to you about two or three different ways in which you can do this. The most canonical way of doing it is indeed by switching to improvable actions in all of your improvable states. So when people say policy iteration, normally they think of greedy policy iteration. If you have five improvable states, you switch to improvable actions in all five of those states. So C pi is exactly equal to I of pi. Okay? This is called Howard's policy iteration, and it was not until a 1999 paper, right, 40 years later, that there was a bound on the number of iterations of Howard's policy iteration, which was shown to be order of k to the n over n, right? We've gone from k to the n, which is a trivial bound, to k to the n over n, okay? Now, remember that our theorem holds for any choice of c pi. It doesn't have to be exactly equal to I of pi. So there's a randomized version of policy iteration by Mansoor and Singh, right? We're going to call this RPI, I think, in the remaining slides, where c pi is chosen to be a subset that is chosen uniformly at random from among the non-empty subsets of I of pi. So if you have, let's go back to my favorite example of having five improvable states, right? How many non-empty subsets could we have of such a set?
At least 31.
Yes, 31, right? So you have 2 to the 5 subsets of which one is not valid because it's empty. And then you choose uniformly at random from any of those 31. And you keep doing this, and that is called Mansoor and Singh's randomized policy iteration algorithm. Because it's a randomized algorithm, you get bounds that are an expectation, right? And Mansoor and Singh have slightly improved analysis when you have two action MDPs, when k equal to 2. And they show that this should take no more than 2 to the 0.78 n iterations to complete. For general k, it is something like k over 2 to the n. Okay, k over 2 to the n is still much better than k to the n over n. All right? So again, so this is the number of iterations. What's the complexity of each iteration? Sorry? It's n cubed or something like that, okay? Some poly of m and k. Okay, so yeah, these are the references. And again, to note now, are that these bounds, right, do not depend on b and gamma. The complexity of Howard's policy iteration is poly of n k times k to the n over n. Okay, there is no dependence on B and gamma because your policy evaluation does not depend on B and gamma. If you assume that you can do precise, exact floating point arithmetic, regardless of the size of your representation, then the number of such operations that you will perform can be bounded purely in terms of N and K. And this multiplied by a polynomial of N and K is the computational complexity of these algorithms. Yeah? Okay, good. So this is also our interest, right? What we contribute is also an algorithm that we intend to bound in terms of n and k alone, with no dependence on gamma and the size of the representation.
So what is the Hollander's thing?
Yeah, so I wrote this in shorthand, right? So Mansoor and Singh showed that this is no more than, I think, 6 times k to the n over n. And Hollander's et al. Said, no, the same algorithm is not more than 2 plus order little o of 1 times k to the n over n. There's been a lot of effort even like playing with the constants in these bounds, right? You would imagine k to the n over n is basically exponential, right? But I mean, strictly speaking, it's somewhat better than just k to the n, right? And yeah, this has been an effort that has taken really long because the algorithm is very simple. I think people have very little understanding or control of the structure of these algorithms, really how they traverse the space of policies. Bounding things becomes very difficult.
So any lower bounds?
For policy iteration, there is one which I will describe on my future work slide, which has some problems. So, an MDP has been constructed on which Howard's policy iteration will take at least 2 to the n iterations, okay, where n is the number of states. Turns out this is an MDP which does not have a fixed number of actions per state. It is not, in our definition, it does not have k actions per state. It can have a variable number of actions from each state. And indeed, some of these states have as many as order n actions. So there is an exponential dependence on the number of states, but the MDP definition is somewhat different from this. It actually causes a problem for us. It's a good point.
Shivaram?
Yes?
Why do you find it desirable that the complexity does not depend on gamma? Gamma is part of the problem definition.
Right.
It should appear.
It does not appear in these.
But why is that a desirable thing? Maybe you are getting something weak by supremizing over all gamma.
Well, you could argue in practice, you could make a if it depends on gamma, you can make it arbitrarily bad by making gamma closer and closer to 1. Right? But this is, I will tell you purely for theoretical curiosity. Right? We are in the regime of strong algorithms in terms of strength being defined in terms of not having the dependence either on B or on gamma. In practice, value iteration works quite well. In gamma.
Because the gamma is coded into that computational, which is in the computational I5, right?
Right.
Gamma is coded in the computational I5.
Gamma is.
The discount, right?
It is there in Bellman's equation,
it
right?
It is there in Q. Value, not a complexity. Correct. It is not as a complex, it is assumed to be there.
No, I think Ankur's question is why do we want bounds that do not depend on gamma, right? Gamma definitely determines what your solution is. The question is,
for example, these bounds won't work. Whereas this method will work.
It takes care of gamma, but it does not.
Okay, so precisely what have we contributed against this backdrop? Let us look at it. We've seen that linear programming gives us poly NKB. Additionally, 1 over 1 minus gamma with value iteration. Policy iteration has different variants with different complexity analyses. The best we know of is Mansoor and Singh's randomized version, which has something like k over 2 to the n in expectation, multiplied by poly n, all right? So we give an algorithm called PGPI, which improves this bound, right? From k over 2 to the n to square root of k to the n. So the bound remains exponential. Except that rather than k over 2, we have square root k in the base. All right, this is a very simple randomized algorithm, which I will explain in some detail. The key construction that we rely upon for analyzing the algorithm is a total order on the set of policies, which I will introduce to you. And as you will see, the analysis is very straightforward. We also show that by combining PGPI with randomized policy iteration, you can even improve upon this slightly. All right, you can do slightly better than k to the n over 2 for, especially for k equal to 2. But it is worth mentioning at this point, okay? So this is something that I'm not too certain about, but it is actually true that you can derive these strong bounds also for linear programming. All right, you can do simplex, for example. So simplex, it has been shown the standard way of doing simplex can have these exponential chains. All right, but randomized versions of simplex where you pivot randomly, some of them have been shown to have sub-exponential complexity. The number of steps that you need to hit your optimal solution is sub-exponential in the number of variables and constraints. Now it turns out for us that the number of variables and constraints are n and n times k, right? One way or the other. So it's not completely clear in my head whether the sub-exponential bounds here directly lead to sub-exponential bounds in the MDP regime. Maybe they do, maybe they do not, right? It's really, the burden of proof is on me to read the linear programming papers well and the next version of this talk have this question resolved, right? Do you see what I'm saying? So this is exponential, right? It's k to the order of n, right? But if we had k to the square root of n over here, that would be sub-exponential. It would not be exponential. So do these sub-exponential bounds for linear programming imply that similar bounds exist for MDP planning? It's not directly obvious because the number of variables and constraints are not n and k, right? They are n and nk, or nk and n. So some work is needed to understand this for a start. But then also you'll start, I hope, seeing parallels between linear programming and MDP planning. In particular, between simplex and policy iteration. They seem to be very similar in having this idea that you start where you are and then you locally see how you can improve and you improve. Right? And in particular, randomized pivoting looks very similar to randomized policy iteration. But at this point, I'll describe my algorithm to you unless there are questions. Fine. Okay, this is PGPI. We are going to define a total ordering on a set of policies, right? So for every policy pi, let us define this number v of pi to be the sum of all the state values of pi. V pi of s is the expected long-term return you'll get by starting at s and following pi. Add up all the v pi of s for all your states and call that a scalar associated with your policy, v of pi. Let capital L be any arbitrary tie-breaking rule that we want. You can have it as the lexicographic ordering over policies or anything else that you want. L is a total order, right? It's an arbitrary total order on the policies. Now we are going to define a total order, let's call this succeeds, all right? A will succeed B, which is defined as follows. For every two policies, pi 1 and pi 2, we're going to define that pi 1 succeeds pi 2. Maybe let's call it exceeds, not succeeds. Pi 1 exceeds pi 2 if, in terms of this scalar value, pi 1 exceeds pi 2. Or on the other hand, if these values are equal, right? Then in the tie-breaking rule that we have adopted, pi 1 exceeds pi 2. All right, so if L is a total ordering, then so is exceeds. Fine? What this gives us, it seems very trivial, but it gives us, I think, in a very novel way, a way to compare any two policies that we have. If you do policy iteration, your standard analysis will at some point depend on a partial ordering, right? We said that if you go from pi to pi prime will state-wise dominate pi. In that sense, pi prime exceeds pi. Right? But you could certainly have two policies which do not state-wise dominate each other. We have one policy exceeding the other policy on some states and the other one exceeding this on some states. Here, on the other hand, because we're adding up these values, we have this ability now to compare any two policies on par using this definition of a total order. But note that the definition is not that thoughtless, right? There is some thought into it. Specifically, our definition is such that the following happens. If we do policy improvement, if we go from pi to pi prime by doing policy improvement, then indeed, pi prime will also exceed pi in terms of this total ordering. So why is that? We just saw that if pi prime is obtained by doing policy improvement to pi, then this is true, right? For every state, it will be at least as good, and there will exist at least one state in which it is strictly better. So now if you add up all these inequalities, then you get that this definition-wise, v of pi prime will exceed v of pi, and therefore, pi prime will exceed pi. Pi 1 will exceed pi 2. I think this should be pi prime exceeds pi. Yes? Okay, so what do we have? We have a total ordering on the policies which respect the partial order, which respect the fact that if a policy state-wise dominates another policy, so will it exceed this policy in the total order. But then any two policies in the total order can be compared. Okay, so now this gives us a very easy sort of way to design an algorithm for MDP planning. Okay, so instead of thinking in the space of policies for a second, let's zone out of that part of the world and look at this, right? This is a game. Here is the number line with numbers 1 through capital N. I'd like somebody to volunteer to play this game. You are born on some point on this number line, okay? You're created somewhere. And there are two things that you can do. One thing you can do is to increment yourself. By applying the increment operator, if you're at I, you will go to I plus 1. The other operator that you have at your disposal is called a guess. Okay, what happens if you guess? A number is picked uniformly at random between 1 and n. Alright, any of these numbers could show up. They show up with equal probability. And so for example, right? For example, you might be shown this number if you guessed. Alright, you'll be in fact shown this with probability 1 over n. And if you wanted, you can move yourself from I to that position. Right? You might also be shown 3, and if you wanted, you can demote yourself from I to 3. Your objective in playing this game is to increment and guess in any way you want, with the objective of reaching the top, right? Reaching capital N as quickly as possible. The question is, how many operations do we need to quickly reach N? So don't really bother about where you're, maybe you're initialized at 1. Okay, let's take the worst case. How many guesses and increments do you need in order to reach capital N? Log N. And how would you do that?
So usually if you guess, there is half probability that the guess would be somewhere on the top.
Correct.
You increment yourself there. But if the guess is below, if half probability is down.
Correct.
So every time it's down, you increment yourself. Oh no, sorry, it's like N log N probability. No, sorry.
N?
No. So if it's below your this thing, then you increment. If it's above, then you just drop.
Jump, right? So, but why would this take log N?
No, it would probably not take log N. But the first, on the first step, you can, with probability half, go to
correct.
1 by 2.
True.
Then you just need to, with probability 1 by 4, you will be going at 10 by 4. I think it will still take the number.
Okay, so that's his hunch. Other people, what's the trivial bound on this?
N.
N, right? You just keep incrementing. In a deterministic sense, you will not take more than order N, right? But the hope is that by guessing, you can have some of these dramatic jumps early on. So especially if you're, let's say, here, right? With a very, very high chance, if you guess, you're going to end up somewhere above where you are, right? You should not be incrementing if you're way down. If on the other hand, you're at N minus 1, right? Would you want to guess at all? So it seems like lower down you should guess, if you're higher up you should increment. That seems like the intuition, but where is this inflection going to happen, right? How much time, how many operations will be needed as a function? And log N is a very reasonable guess. Correct. So the way I have described to you, you actually know where you are, right? But when we map this back to MDPs, we will not know. It does not make too much of a difference. The difference is really like a constant factor. The difference between knowing and not knowing is essentially a constant factor. Even if you did not know where you are, right? There is a way of guessing and incrementing by doing which you will only be a constant factor worse off than what you could do if you knew where you were. So assume you know where you are.
So you will probably should guess if
no whether I'm gonna always guess something about that. Right?
So your guess operation is as follows. Regardless of where you are, a number will be chosen uniformly at random from 1 to n. Okay? It does not depend on where you are. And if you want, you can move to that number. If you don't want, you can stay put.
Square root n
should do it.
Yeah.
Second guess of the answer. I mean, it's got to be less than n, right? N is the worst you can do. So it has to be square root n or log n or n to the 2/3 or all of these things, right? So indeed, yeah, square root n is the best you can do. I'm not going to analyze it, but what essentially happens is you can show, right, this game indeed sets up a Markov chain. right, from any of these points, right? You can either guess or you can increment. And one of them is the optimal thing to do because you can define a reward of -1 for every operation that you incur, right? And the value, the long-term value of any of these, of a policy from any of these, I'm always tempted to call these states, right? But I don't want you to get confused with the states from before. From any of these notches, right? There is an optimal thing to do, either guessing or incrementing, and you can show, right, that the optimal policy that gets induced will have this form, right, up to a certain point, right, from n through some threshold. The right thing to do there and upwards is to increment, all right, and from everywhere below the threshold, the right thing to do is to guess. You'll see that that threshold is something like n minus order square root of n. Square root of n is roughly the right thing you can do. So this is how you might do it. So Pratik's question was whether we know where we are or we do not. So I'm going to describe an algorithm where actually we don't even need to know where we are. It's just enough for us to know whether the guess has taken us to a point that's above us or below us. We don't need to know the indices themselves. So the algorithm is essentially you guess square root n times. Each time, if your guess takes you a point that is above you, you just go there. Having done this square root n times, you just increment. It's possible to show that after square root n guesses, with enough probability, you will be in this zone with already in the top square root n, right? And therefore, you can't take more than square root n more if you just increment it from there. So here's what you'll do. You'll guess. You were given a point that lies above you. You'll move yourself there. You'll guess again. No, this falls below. I will not go there. I'll stay put. Guess again, go up. Guess again, go up. Guess again. No, I'll stay put. I've guessed enough times. Now I'll increment. All right? So if you guess square root 10 times, you'll be in this green zone. And then if you increment again, you need an additional square root of 10. All right? So this is the algorithm. I mean, there are other ways in which you can do it, right? But the square root 10 is a sort of a fundamental limit that you'll reach. So the expected number of operations for playing this game, right, is order of square root 10. OK? So what's the connection to this game and the MDP planning problem?
N square root of n.
Sorry?
Square root of n.
Right. So each of these points is a policy. Right. Let's order our policies. Remember, we introduced the total ordering. You arrange your policies. There'll be an optimal policy there on the top. And the worst policy, in some sense, will be here. You guess. Right. What does it mean to guess? You pick a policy uniformly at random from all your policies. That's very easy to do, right? You just go to every state and pick an action uniformly at random. You keep doing this, you'll get a policy that's drawn uniformly at random from your set of policies. You evaluate your policy, your current policy and the one you have guessed. If this policy dominates your current policy in the total order, you switch to it. If it does not, you don't switch to it, right? You do this square root of capital N times, where capital N is the total number of policies. Then onwards, you just increment, right? In fact, by doing policy improvement, you're guaranteed that you'll go up at least by one, right? In practice, you might go up by more than one notch by applying standard policy improvement, okay? So this is our algorithm. Start with an arbitrary policy. Repeat, take alpha to be half, all right, for the present. So repeat square root of the total number of policies. Draw policy uniformly at random. If pi prime exceeds pi, switch, otherwise don't switch. And until you reach an optimal policy, from wherever you had reached at the end of this repetitive phase, you just do policy improvement, okay? Essentially, the analysis of that game translates to the analysis of this to show that this will not take more than order of k to the n over 2 policy evaluations and expectation, all right? That's with alpha equal to half. Now, you can do slightly better than this by picking alpha to be 0.46. If you are agreeing to use randomized policy improvement as your policy improvement. Any policy improvement will give an increment of 1, right? But slightly more tighter analysis is available if we use Mansoor and Singh's randomized policy improvement. So if we did that, then it's possible to show that alpha equal to 0.46 suffices for getting a bound of 2 to the 0.46n and k equal to 2. You also get a tighter bound for general k, but that doesn't look nearly as neat as this, all right? So what have we seen? So we have this randomized game. We have this game for which we demonstrated that a simple randomized guessing strategy works. It takes something like the order of the square root of the total number of numbers, which we then translate into the case of MDP planning, which is the number of policies. And by doing this, we get the bound that we had claimed. And we can also show that you can do slightly better by applying randomized policy improvement. Yes?
So this is the way to do it. If we were into saying that just select that many random policies, pick the best one with high probability it will belong to the top, whatever for time, and then just move it.
That's exactly the lemma in our paper, is basically that. That if you guess, if you guess capital N to the alpha times, with enough of probability you will be in the top N to the 1 minus alpha. Right? And so alpha is, if you choose it to be half, you get the first result.
So the only catch is that tie breaking thing doesn't, so somehow you are assuming uniform distribution of those tie breaker and those lexicographic comparisons. That's the only thing that can mess it up.
Doesn't mess it up.
No, I'm just like wondering that, see, when we talk about choosing, if there was no lexicographic tie breaker, then the probability works out nice. Otherwise, there is some uniformity assumptions of the tie breaking that has to come into the play for it to complete.
Right. So, you need this just to be like technically precise, because it is possible that you could have different policies with the same values. In practice, it might never happen. But if it does happen, then to define a total ordering, you do need to have a well-defined tie breaking tool.
So it doesn't matter what is ordering. Any ordering on those things, you know, just pick anything.
Right. The real progress is happening because of the policy improvement. It's not happening because of the tie breaking. In fact, there could be multiple optimal policies too, right? Ours will find the one that amongst those also wins the tie break. All right, good. So I'll go to like a conclusion of this. So we've introduced this algorithm which improves upon the known bounds in terms of n and k alone, right? Which is strong in the sense of not having a dependence on the size of your representation or the discount factor. It's a randomized algorithm. I cannot really help not think about the fact that using policy iteration for MDP planning seems very analogous to using simplex for linear programming. So what is simplex doing? You start at some vertex of your polytope. You keep looking for your neighbors and the ones that improve your objective function. You switch to one of them based on your pivoting rule, either randomly or deterministically. You keep doing this. In the worst case, simplex can take exponential time if you're doing deterministic pivoting using the standard simplex. But then if you randomize, you can actually get some exponential time. That's what some of these papers have not mentioned here, but some of the work from the 90s says it's randomized simplex will give you some exponential time. Now, similar with policy iteration, we see that Howard's can take a long time, but when you randomize, you get better performance. In both cases, we get these bounds solely in terms of the number of constraints, the number of states and actions in MDPs, the number of constraints and variables for simplex, no dependence on the size of your representation, right? Unlike the interior point method. Turns out that we are not getting very good experimental results with PGPI, for the reason that this bound of k to the n or k to the n over n, which are upper bounds for policy iteration, seem to be extremely conservative on most MDPs, right? If you say I'll draw my MDP from a distribution, I'll draw the rewards from a Gaussian and the transitions from a Dirichlet, something like that, you'll end up with an MDP which takes policy iteration like 5 iterations to converge. It's remarkably fast, and it's not even understood why policy iteration is that efficient. So our hope, we assume, would be in MDPs which are provably difficult for policy iteration, right? So very recently, like 5 years back, Fernley constructed an MDP which takes 2 to the n iterations for policy iteration, for Howard's policy iteration. It turns out, though, as I mentioned, that Fernley's MDP is one where the number of actions is variable per state. You don't have like fixed number of actions per state. And therefore, the number of policies is much, much larger than k to the n or 2 to the n. It becomes more like n to the n because you have lots of states which have as many of order n, as order n actions. And so on those MDPs, the square root of the total number of policies is also something like n to the n, right, or n to the n over 2, which is much bigger than 2 to the n. So we hypothesize that our method is going to work well on problems which have bounded width, which have like a small number of actions, constant number of actions per state, on which you can still show that policy iteration takes an exponential thing. So this is a well-defined like problem for you. Is there an MDP with k actions per state with n states on which there is an initial policy from which if you start and did Howard's policy iteration, you will still have an exponential change. You'll have some C to the N iterations that you will have to negotiate before you find the optimum policy, where C can either be a constant or it can be some a function of K, right? We are not aware of such a work yet. And for that reason, essentially PGPI turns out to do a lot of wasteful guesses. If you just did policy iteration, you're going to do so well, right? So what's the point of doing all these square root of number of policies guesses? It's good in theory. It's not very clear that it's good in practice on most practically appearing MDPs. Okay, so these are references. I told you there's a long history of this, and some of these have been open problems for a long, long time. And so it is really surprising that our very simple method gives a fairly significant improvement in the exponential bound. But if anything, I think this opens like slew of possibilities, right? Especially the connections with linear programming seem too tempting not to look further into it. So if there are students who would like to take a look, I'd be very happy to talk with you. And with that, I'll thank you very much.
Imposing a linear order on the policies.
We are constructing a total order, a linear order, yes. We assume you pick any tie-breaking rule you want, right? Maybe just stick with the lexicographic ordering of policies. But if we define a scalar for each policy that is the sum of the state values, then combined with your tie-breaking rule that imposes a total order.
Can you show you LP?
Yeah.
So what are the vertices, what do they look like? I mean, those must have been analyzed long ago.
What are the, no, I'm not very...
There is some work effort on the link between policy iteration and the dual of the LP formulation.
Correct. So the dual has variables like the stationary distribution.
So doing the simplex in the dual seems to be very close to what policy iteration is. So maybe the counterexample, like the T-Menti kind of counterexample could give you have you looked at?
No, I'm not aware of this work. So
no, but this is a very specific linear program. Yeah. Clementi will not work on this.
No, but there have been Clementi examples on MDPs. This is published. I don't remember the citation, but there is a Clementi type of example for MDPs, but again only on the simplex approach. This is a different approach. It is not the LP. So there is also for the simplex on MDPs, it's known that it is strongly polynomial. I thought Fernley had a result on that.
No, that's if you assume like a constant discount factor or something like that.
Right, with some...
Okay, yeah, we want no dependence either on gamma or on B. If you can get a strongly polynomial algorithm for MDP planning, and you're a PhD student, you can write your thesis.
There was something, but I don't know, maybe you should ask Ashutosh, he was telling me about this.
No,
That assumes the discount factor.
There is a dependence on gamma. But anyway, this is useful that the dual will look like doing simplex on the dual looks like policy iteration, is what you're saying.
Okay.
No, it doesn't fix it. No, I think we're going after more targeted questions, right?
So you're saying this is a very specific instance to problem. The whole of LP may not be in favor.
But you don't want dependent on bits.
Sorry?
You don't want dependent on B here.
Correct, we don't.
The dual is not necessarily.
No, the dual will also not have the dependence on. Doing simplex in general will not have the dependence on B. Which is why you'll get a sub-exponential rather than a polynomial number of iterations.
State action pair or something like that. So just make it slightly
more structured. Richer,
yeah, more structured, and walk in that space. Will that help?
That's very good intuition. The only problem is it's very difficult to intuit in this space. You can construct examples where doing what seems to be the right thing in many states might end up being the wrong thing.
I see. In the global.
Correct. Right. Yeah, so this also ties in with, I think, our first guess of log n, right? If you can do log n for playing that game, then you can do this in strongly polynomial time. And the way of doing log n would be to generate guesses uniformly at random from only those policies that are between you and the optimal policy, right? There's some way in which you can only guess policies that are already guaranteed to be better than you, at least with high probability.
Yeah. No, yeah. I was trying to say that, you know, you look at a policy as a vector, and I sort of do bitwise improvement on that. Like, if the bits, the first few bits of my policies are all 1, 1, 1, then I should only guess on the remaining bits of the encoding of my policy or something like that. I mean, say the best policy is all 1s, and the worst is, say, all 0s.
Sure.
If there was a way to encode policies in this way, and then sort of bitwise, I mean, it's very vague.
So, by the way, if the best policy is all 1s, the worst may not be all 0s. It could be all 1s except the last one, which is 0.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, such an encoding cannot exist.
Maybe you're pushing it under that rug, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That your encoding is doing the magic for you.
Right.
So, Shivaram, your increment increments the value. So, it is not moving, you know, it's not I plus 1 on the on your scale.
The increment in our algorithm is switching to a new policy.
So, it goes up somewhere. You don't know where it is. Right. It increments the value.
Correct.
It increments the distance from the test.
No, no, it increments the value. Right?
Correct, the scalar associated with the policy.
So why do you need this other ordering? You just pick root n randomly, choose the best, and then you increment the value, but you'll always do it within square root.
We do it in square root n.
You don't need this,
the total order.
You don't need the total order at all, is what I'm saying.
The total order is to say that you're in the top square root n. How do you define top?
But you will be anyway. See, it
no, but you have to define what does it mean to the top?
There is a partial order anyway. Yeah. And when you increment, you move in the partial order.
He's
correct.
Saying that
right?
Any chain in your partial order is of a certain length.
But your guesses need not be on the chain.
It doesn't matter, but you will be on a level where the top square root n is. So you will only move up square root n after your guess.
So you will get into how much mass there is at each level of this partial order.
Because of that square root n,
in fact you may be worse off with your total ordering. Because your partial ordering say, suppose that okay, along any of the path you can be within root n. When you do total order, all these paths get superimposed, linearized. So you actually may be below. So therefore the partial ordering may
be. Yeah, but how do you only guess on your path?
No, see, the top square root n, right, they will fall on some in some order.
Okay.
Some order, the first you order by whichever way you want, it will land up somewhere. Now you will certainly be above this because the number is greater than square root n. And then
right.
You know the partial order, you only walk square root n more.
Correct.
That's it.
So you're saying you don't need the total order?
You don't.
I guess, yeah, you could say that.
No, I'm saying it may give you better analysis. If anything, the partial order may give you better tighter bound than total order, or it may give the same.
So you're saying it
won't be worse off
of the partial order. Depth of the path, the longest diameter.
You
of the
will feel that square root n below it, because the number is greater. In fact, if you have a fatter partial order, then you will be much above.
Yeah.
So if actually you knew something about your partial order, then even fewer than square root n guesses might do.
Yeah.
Right.
Suppose you.
But then we don't.
No,
we are making no assumption about what we.
But you are not even using your total order.
We are, right? In defining that we are in the top square root n, right? What is top square root n?
No, we are going to take the best of your square root n guesses and start from that.
What does it mean, best in under what definition?
You have the objective.
No, because you, let's say you n is 9 and you guess 3 times, right? You might have 3 policies, none of which state-wise dominates each other. It might be incomparable in terms of state-wise domination. You still have to pick one of them and call it your best. For that, we need the total.
Choose the largest value. Right? Yeah, largest
value as defined by our definition.
Not
that's the definition I'm calling like synonymous with the total.
No, this d pi, d sub pi.
Okay, one sec. Let's go to.
Yeah.
Here? No, let's go to the total audience. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah.
If you have three things that equal, choose any one.
Yeah.
You don't need
that's
to
exactly what he's saying.
Which is, I'm saying you, your L can be anything. I'm saying the same thing you're saying, except I'm saying upfront what how we choose.
No.
But yes,
the
total
is
just look at d pi. Don't look at d of pi.
But d pi is a vector. D pi is a vector.
No. Okay. So did you evaluate?
This is what you're talking
no,
about, right?
Each policy
there
is a very defined
value. Yeah, for each policy there is a very defined value. Value for policy. What is the value? Under each state. No, V pi is a value function, right? It's a vector.
No, but another from somewhere else you have that.
Yeah.
From somewhere else? No. This is what we have. The value function of a policy is an n value, n length vector. Which is why we need to collapse all of them into one number. That's exactly what total order is doing. Except we don't. Good. No more questions means we'll stop.